मॉर्निंग डियर स्टूडेंट्स, आई एम प्रदीप हीरापुरे, असिस्टेंट प्रोफेसर. टुडे आई एम गोइंग टू डिलीवर माय लेक्चर ऑन द टॉपिक जेल इलेक्ट्रोफोरेसिस. डियर स्टूडेंट्स, ऑलरेडी आई डिलीवर माय लेक्चर ऑन बेसिक प्रिंसिपल ऑफ जेल इलेक्ट्रोफोरेसिस एज वेल एज द पेपर इलेक्ट्रोफोरेसिस. And this one is the second lecture for jail electrophoresis. So in this lecture, I would like to explain the process of jail electrophoresis. What are the types of jail electrophoresis? Dear students, in this today's lecture, I will cover the agarose jail electrophoresis, its principle, procedure, and application, as well as I would like to explain the SDS page electrophoresis and its application, and native page electrophoresis and its application. Dear students, first of all, I would like to explain the basic principle of gel electrophoresis. Dear students, you know very well, in my last lecture, I already explained the general principle of electrophoresis. The electrophoresis is nothing but the process in which, under the influence of electric current, the charge bearing particle start to migrate toward the opposite charge electrode, and this migration speeds depends upon the molecular weight and charge of that particular molecule. And with the help of this electrophoresis techniques, we can separate the various types of molecules which bear the particular charge. It may be the positive charge or it may be the negative charge. So in previous lecture, I already explained the general principle of electrophoresis, but today I am going to deliver the gel electrophoresis, and that's why I would like to explain the principle of gel electrophoresis. Dear students, in last lecture we discuss about the paper electrophoresis, means the electrophoresis in which we use the paper as a medium, and from the medium various types of charged molecules travels toward the opposite charge electrode when we apply the electric current. But in the gel electrophoresis, we use the gel as a medium. Now there is a different types of gel we can use in the electrophoresis. It may be the agarose gel, it may be the starch, or it may be the polyacrylamide gel. So gel electrophoresis in which we replace that paper with gel. And why we use the gel? Because the gelling agent, it may be the agarose or it may be the polyacrylamide, that gel when we dissolve in a water or buffer and heat it, then these gelling agent chemically cross-link to each other and form a pores and form a solid porous nature. And that gel is a porous in nature, that's why when we apply the sample within the well of that gel, that sample can travel through the gel, and on the basis of sieving effect or on the basis of friction force acted by your gel medium on a molecule, your molecule travels towards the opposite electrode with a different speed. And depending upon the molecular weight, your molecules start to separate within this gel. So dear students, in the gel electrophoresis, we use a gel as a medium, and these gels nothing but the agarose gel and acrylamide gel. Depending upon what type of gel we use in the electrophoresis technique classify into the different types. If you use the agarose gel, then that electrophoresis technique known as agarose gel electrophoresis. If you use the polyacrylamide gel for the electrophoresis, the process known as a polyacrylamide gel electrophoresis. Dear students, when we prepared the gel or when we cast the gel, before performing the electrophoresis process, after the solidification of that gel, you keep that gel inside the buffer, or you can keep that gel in such a way that gel should be equilibrated with the buffer solution, and that buffer solution having ions, and when we apply the electric current to that buffer solution, the ion particles of the buffer start to carry the electric current and start to migrate toward the opposite charge electrode. And when the current is on, under the influence of electric current, your molecules also start to carry the some current, just because of the particular charge will be there. So dear students, when your molecule start to migrate through that porous nature of the gel, there will be the sieving force acted by your gel, or sieving force acted by gel on a molecule. And bigger this molecule or higher molecular weight molecule, when migrate through that pore, it will slow down. Why? Because the highest sieving force acted by your medium or gel on a high molecular weight molecule. If your molecule is low molecular weight or small in size, then your medium acted sieving effect or acted sieving force on that molecule, but it is very low. And that's why the lower or low molecular weight molecule migrate toward the opposite electrode through the gel medium very fastly, as compared to the larger molecule or the molecule having higher molecular weight. And that's why whenever we consider any sample, and in that sample there is a different types of molecule which having a different molecular weight, so such type of sample when we load on the gel and we provide the electric current and perform the electrophoresis, so under the influence of electric current, your different molecules travels with a different speed. And that's why, due to the different speed, after some time interval or when switch off the electrophoresis technique, so within the gel, your different molecules cover the different distance. Okay, so the lowest molecular weight molecule cover highest distance within the gel, and the highest molecular weight molecule cover lowest distance within the gel. So dear students, I would like to convey my message to you. Within the gel electrophoresis, the molecular high molecular weight molecules slowly migrate, and the small molecular weight or low molecular weight molecule fastly migrate, and due to the molecular differences, our molecule can separate out within this gel electrophoretic process. So this is all about the principle of gel electrophoresis. Dear student, basically gel electrophoresis techniques or methods classify into the two types: horizontal gel electrophoresis and vertical gel electrophoresis. Dear students, horizontal gel electrophoresis, nothing but the migration of your molecule horizontally, and that's why that gel electrophoresis known as a horizontal gel electrophoresis, and for example agarose gel electrophoresis. Normally in our laboratory we perform agarose gel electrophoresis for the separation of nucleic acid, so that agarose gel electrophoresis always perform in a horizontal electrophoretic unit, and your DNA molecule migrated toward the opposite charge electrode horizontally, and that's why this agarose gel electrophoresis known as a horizontal type of electrophoresis. One another type, vertical electrophoresis, in which your molecule migrate in vertical direction, and for example the polyacrylamide gel electrophoresis. Dear students, you know very well In polyacrylamide gel electrophoresis we perform, there is a two different or variation of the polyacrylamide gel electrophoresis. It may be the SDS page or native page. So whatever the polyacrylamide gel electrophoresis we perform in a laboratory, at which we use the vertical gel electrophoretic unit, and in which our molecule migrates vertically, and that's why this technique known as a vertical gel electrophoresis. Dear students, before going to discuss about the agar gel electrophoresis, first of all I would like to explain the different types of gels and its property and how these gels we can use in a gel electrophoresis. So basically there is a three different types of gelling agent. It may be the starch, agarose and polyacrylamide. Dear students, starch is a organic polymer, and when we mix this starch powder into the distilled water and boil it, so the starch molecule solubilize in a water, and when we cool that solution, so your starch solution start to solidify, and we can prepare in this way the solid gel. So that's why this starch molecules are starch gelling agent for electrophoresis or gel electrophoresis. But out of these three, we routinely perform the agar gel electrophoresis and polyacrylamide gel electrophoresis. Dear students, you can observe here, this one is the starch molecule, and that starch molecule when boil with water and after heating or boiling, then allow it to cool, and then this starch molecule cross link to each other and form a solid gel, and that solid gel having a pores or particular specific pore size. If you increase the concentration of gelling agent, then the porosity will be decreased, and if you reduce the concentration of gelling agent, then the porosity will be increased. Likewise, this agar gel electrophoresis, specifically this electrophoresis we perform for the separation of nucleic acid. So in agar gel electrophoresis we use agarose. So this one is the structure of agarose molecule, and this agarose molecules again we can boil with water or buffer and allow it to cool, then agarose molecule also able to solidify. So we can prepare the solid block of the agarose molecule. So dear students, I would like to explain in detail about the agarose and polyacrylamide. So agarose gel is a polymer compound, and it composed of repeating disaccharide unit called agarobiose, which consists of galactose and 3,6 anhydrogalactose. Agarose gives a more uniform degree of porosity than starch, and this may be varied by altering the starting concentration of suspension. If we use a low concentration, it will give the large pores, while high concentrations gives smaller pores. The gel has found widespread use specifically in the separation of DNA molecule. Electrophoretic procedure involve protein samples such as immunoelectrophoresis, in which also we can use the agarose as a gelling agent, as a medium. Dear students, because of the uniform charge distribution in a nucleic acid, it is possible to accurately determine the DNA molecular masses based on the mobility in agarose gel. However, the limited mechanical stability of agarose, while sufficient to form a stable horizontal gel comprise the possibility for post electroporotic manipulation. Now I would like to explain the acrylamide. The acrylamide is also a polymer and a far stronger gel suitable for electroporotic separation. This acrylamide gel electrophoresis we routinely perform for the separation of protein as well as for the separation of nucleic acid. This polyacrylamide gel we prepared in a laboratory for performing the polyacrylamide gel electrophoresis, we required the two component or two chemical molecules. It is acrylamide and bisacrylamide. This acrylamide and bisacrylamide having property to cross-link to each other in presence of the ammonium persulfate and thymate. When we add the acrylamide and bisacrylamide and ammonium persulfate and thymate, so there is no need to heat the solution. This acrylamide molecule start to cross-link with the bisacrylamide molecule and form a polyacrylamide molecules or form a polyacrylamide complex. And due to this property, we can prepare the polyacrylamide gel, which is a solid gel, in a laboratory, and we routinely utilize for the polyacrylamide gel electrophoresis. Now, dear students, first of all, I would like to explain the agarose gel electrophoresis. You know very well agarose gel electrophoresis, in which we prepare the gel by utilizing the agarose powder, and that gel kept horizontally in a electrophoretic unit. You can observe in this slide. This one is the electrophoretic unit, and within that unit we prepared the gel. So after addition of agarose powder and your buffer, then boil it and till the clear solution appear, and after that allow it to cool up to the 55 degree Celsius temperature, and then that molten agarose gel will pour inside the cavity or inside the electrophoretic unit or electrophoretic chamber, and allow it to solidify. So dear student, we prepared the agarose gel block within this electrophoretic unit, and already we immersed the comb also just before the solidification of agarose gel. And when remove the comb, there will be the vials, and within that vials we can load our sample. So this, when we provide the electric current, you can observe here in this slide, this one is the electrode and this one is also the electrode. This one is positive electrode, this one is a negative electrode, and toward the negative electrode there will be the vials, and inside the vials the DNA sample will be loaded. Okay, so after the sample application, when we provide the electric current, so under the influence of electric current, your DNA molecule, your nucleic acid molecule start to migrate toward the positive electrode through the gel, and these directions will be horizontal, and that's why this type of agarose gel electrophoresis also known as a horizontal gel electrophoresis. Dear students, in agarose gel electrophoresis, we required the comb for the well creation, and we required the electrophoretic unit in which the electrode, there is a positive electrode and negative electrode, which is made up of the platinum specifically, and we need a power supply also and cords. So these are the different types of component required for the agarose gel electrophoresis. Apart from this, again we required some chemicals for this electrophoresis. we required the buffer, then we required the agarose powder, that is polymeric sugar used to prepare the horizontal gel for DNA analysis. We routinely use the TEE buffer, that is the tris acetate EDTA buffer, in agarose gel electrophoresis. Then we required the ethidium bromide solution, that ethidium bromide solution having a concentration of 10 mg per ml, and this ethidium bromide we utilize in this electrophoresis to visualize the DNA bands or nucleic acid band, because this ethidium bromide molecule act as a intercalating agents, and when we mix this ethidium bromide molecule during the preparation of gel, agarose gel, so ethidium bromide molecule able to intercalate or insert within the double stranded DNA, and that's why when we observed after the completion of electrophoresis that gel observed under the trans illuminator, so the ethidium bromide will emits the fluorescence, orange color fluorescence, and we able to visualize our DNA bands. So for the visualizing purpose, we required ethidium bromide. And then we required the sucrose also for the preparation of loading dye, as well as we required the TrisSCL, which is a component of running buffer, and we again require the bromophenol blue. That is a tracking dye to monitor the process of electrophoresis. So these are the some requirement or some component required for the agarose gel electrophoresis. Now, dear students, I would like to explain how will you prepare the gel in a laboratory. So first of all, we take a conical flask, and in which we add the appropriate quantity of buffer. It may be the 50 ml or it may be the 100 ml. It is depends upon the requirement of electrophoretic unit. So what type of electrophoretic unit you use in a laboratory, with respect to that volume of that electrophoretic unit, you need to prepare the particular volume of agarose gel. So for the preparation of agarose gel, we mix appropriate quantity of agarose powder in a distilled water, or we can say in a buffer, TEE buffer. Okay. So in our laboratory, when we perform the agarose gel electrophoresis, we routinely perform prepared the 1% or 2% agarose gel. So 1% agarose gel means what? The 1 gram agarose powder should be mixed into the 100 ml buffer. So if you want to prepare the 100 ml agarose gel, so you need to weigh the agarose powder and take 1 gram of agarose powder and then add into the buffer. And for the mixing purpose, for the solubilization of this agarose powder into the buffer, you need to heat it, you need to boil it. So at the burner, we boil it, that solution, till appear like a clear solution. And after this, if appear the clear solution, it indicates that whatever the agarose molecule is there, so all the agarose molecule completely solubilize in the buffer. Okay. So after that, you have to wait for some minute and allow it to cool up to 55 degrees Celsius temperature. When your agarose attain 55 degrees Celsius temperature, then you can add the ethidium bromide molecule or ethidium bromide solution. So ethidium, basically, dear student, this ethidium bromide solution is a very carcinogenic in nature. Means if the ethidium bromide molecule enter in our body, so that ethidium bromide molecule is responsible to cause the mutations or to cause the cancer also. So that's why you should handle this ethidium bromide with very carefully manner, and you can add this ethidium bromide molecules or ethidium bromide solution, which is already a stock solution of ethidium bromide, 10 mg per ml. So from that stock solution you can pick up the 8 microliter ethidium bromide for a 100 ml agarose gel. If you prepare the 50 ml agarose gel, so you can take 4 to 5 microliter ethidium bromide. So after addition of this ethidium bromide into the agarose gel, you should mix properly the ethidium molecules or ethidium bromide solution into the agarose gel. After the proper mixing, then you can pour this molten agarose gel into the electrophoretic unit or gel casting tray. So this one is the gel casting tray, and you can observe here this pouring of agarose gel within the electrophoretic chamber or electrophoretic gel casting tray. Okay, so after the pouring, allow it to solidify. So it will take near about half an hour. After half an hour, your gel will be ready to perform the electrophoresis. Now this gel will keep into the electrophoretic unit. Okay, so that electrophoretic unit nothing but the tank or buffer reservoir in which we can keep this solidified gel. Okay, now this solidified gel, when we keep inside the electrophoretic unit, and then we pour the buffer. So your in this agarose gel electrophoresis, your gel totally submerge into the buffer, and that's why this electrophoresis also known as a submerged gel electrophoresis. Why? Because our gel totally submerge into the buffer solution. Now dear students, the preparation of gel is completed. Now we're going to discuss about the application of sample or sample loading into the veins. Okay, so dear students, whatever the comb is there, so that comb should be removed carefully, and after that, after the removal of comb, there is a creation of different veins. Okay, so you can observe in this light, these are the different types of veins actually created when we remove the comb. Okay, so inside the veil you can load the sample, but before sample application or before the sample loading, you need to prepare your sample, because when we add the DNA sample directly into the veil, so it will be float. Why? Because the density of your DNA molecule is low, and that's why your DNA molecule or your nucleic acid molecule may float on the surface of buffer. Okay, so there is a chance of mixing. So to minimize such type of problem, you need to prepare your sample before loading. So how will you prepare the sample for loading? Your DNA sample, it may be the 10 microliter or 15 microliter. It is depends upon the concentration of DNA. For the visualization of DNA, it requires the 20 nanogram per microliter. This one is the recommended concentration. If high concentrated DNA sample is there, so you can take the 10 to 15 microliter DNA molecules or DNA samples mixed into the 3 microliter 6x gel loading buffer. Now dear student, what is actually the gel loading buffer? So that gel loading buffer, nothing but the buffer or the solution in which the sucrose or glycerol molecule is there and the bromophenol blue is there. So this loading buffer prepared by utilizing the sucrose or glycerols as well as the bromophenol blue. So this loading buffer looked in a particular color. If there is a bromophenol blue, so it is looked in a blue color. And this, why we use the loading buffer to prepare the sample? To increase, to enhance the density of our DNA sample. Okay, so when we mix our DNA molecule with the loading buffer, so loading buffer enhance the density, increase the density of your sample. Okay, and that's why when we after the preparation, in such a way that we prepared the sample and then we can load the 10 to 15 microliter sample within this gel, okay, within the vein. And you can use the micropipette, you can use the micropipette, and with the help of sterile micropipette you can load your sample within the gel, okay, within the veins. Okay, now after that there is another molecules or compound is there in loading buffer, that is a bromophenol blue. So that, what is the function of that bromophenol blue? So due to the blue color we can identify whether our sample correctly loaded into the veins or not. Okay, so we can track the samples also during the loading and during the electrophoretic process also. So I will explain in next slide how this bromophenol blue molecule act as a tracking dye. Okay, so after the your sample loading, then you can connect the cords of electrophoretic unit to the power. Okay, so there is a normally in agaro gel electrophoresis we utilize 100 volt to 200 volt electric current. Okay, so we supply the 100 to 200 volt to the electrophoretic unit. So after the connection you can switch on the electric current. After switch on the electric current, you should monitor the near the electrode any bubbles appears or not. If there is a bubbles appears or bubbles will be created at the surface of electrode, so it indicates that your connection is correct and the electrophoresis process correctly start. Now allow it to migrate your molecules through that gel under the influence of electric currents. So dear student, how will you monitor the electrophoretic process? Because if we do not use the bromophenol blue or we do not use the tracking dye during the preparation of your sample, so you unable to track the process of electrophoresis. And that's why the second application of your loading buffer, nothing but the loading buffer is responsible for the tracking of electrophoresis process. So dear student, we continuously monitor it and after some time interval we monitor, so we can appear, we can observe our gel in this way. So here is a vase. Initially we load the sample here, but now after some time we observe that this blue color bands appear at this zone. So this blue color bands nothing but the tracking dye. And this, due to the appearance of this blue color tracking dye, we can monitor the electrophoresis process. So basically this bromophenol blue or whatever the tracking dye we use in during the preparation of nucleic acid sample, so that dye molecule are very low molecular weight molecule, and that's why that dye molecule always migrated toward the opposite charge electrode and always present just in front of the your molecule. So we can track our process and we can identify when we should stop the electrophoresis process. So this blue color bands, nothing but the tracking dye, and just behind these bands your DNA molecule will be migrated. Okay, so with the help of this tracking dye we can monitor the electrophoresis. After the sufficient migration of bromophenol dye, you can decide the when we should stop the electrophoresis process. Now dear student, after the completion of your electrophoretic process, then the next step is visualization of your molecule. So whatever the nucleic acid separated within the gel, that nucleic acid we cannot observe by our naked eye. There is a requirement of special instruments. So basically for the visualization of nucleic acid, already we added the ethidium bromide during the preparation of agar gel, right? So that ethidium bromide molecules fixed in the DNA, and due to the intercalating property of that ethidium bromide molecule, we can visualize the DNA molecule under the UV transilluminator. So dear students, we require the UV transilluminator. UV transilluminator nothing but the instrument in which we can visualize the DNA bands, right? So this transilluminator in which there is a source of UV light. So by utilizing the transilluminator, your electrophoresis gel should be kept on the surface of transilluminator, and from the bottom side there is a UV radiation start to emit in upward direction. And when your DNA molecule or when the ethidium bromide molecule exposed under the UV light, your ethidium bromide molecule start to emit the orange color fluorescence. And due to the fluorescence light emitted by your ethidium bromide molecules, which are already present with the DNA molecules. So within that DNA molecule, ethidium bromide is there, and that's why that ethidium bromide molecule emits the fluorescence, and we can visualize our DNA bands under the UV light, under the transilluminator, and we can analyze the result of electrophoresis. Apart from this, we can use the gel documentation system. That gel documentation systems also based on the UV light or the same principle of transilluminator, but in the gel documentation system there is a specialized camera, that with the help of that camera we can take photographs of our gel, okay, and then we can document that gel pictures in a scientific way for the publishing of research papers. Okay, so dear students, after the visualization there is a last step in agar gel electrophoresis. There is a that is analysis of electrophoretic result. So basically this agar gel electrophoresis in which we can separate the nucleic acid. Now your nucleic acid may be in linear form, maybe it is super coiled in nature, or maybe in a relaxed state. Okay, so dear student, you can observe here, this one is the picture of electrophoresis gel. So you can observe there is a different types of bands. Okay, so these bands appear. So normally what happen when we perform the electrophoresis for the separation of nucleic acid, so your super coiled DNA travels larger distance from the origin of veins, okay, or from the veins, okay. So highest distance will be covered by super coiled DNA as compared to the open circular DNA and linear DNA. And as compared to the linear DNA, open circular DNA cover highest distance, okay, but the lower distance as compared to the super coil. So you can observe here when we run this three different types of molecules, so we get the three different types of bands, and this bottom band nothing but the supercoiled DNA, this one is the open circular DNA, and this one is the linear DNA. So what it indicates, the supercoiled DNA cover larger distance. Why? Because it is very compact in nature, and the whatever the sieving force acted by your medium on this molecule is very less as compared to the open circular and linear one. And when we talking about the linear one, while linear molecule run behind the open circular and super coil, because the linear one when traveling through the medium, so the your medium or gel acted, the sieving force on this linear molecule is very high, and that's why this linear molecule slowly migrated through that gel during the electrophoresis as compared to the super coil and open circular. And that's why this linear molecule remain behind the super coil and open circular DNA. So it is clear that how this super coil and linear DNA separated within the gel. Okay, now I would like to explain this diagrams also. If you want to determine the molecular weight of any unknown molecule, so we load the unknown sample in one well, and in the adjacent well we load the ladder. Now ladder nothing but the known molecular weight markers. So we know already the molecular weight of these fragments. Okay, so this one is the marker DNA bands, and this one is our unknown sample. So on the basis of comparative analysis, your band is appear in the line of 2 kb. Okay, so this band is having a molecular weight of 2 kb, and your unknown samples also lie in the same location. Okay, and that's why we can identify, we can determine the molecular weight of our unknown fragments. So our fragments also having a molecular weight of 2 kb. okay, so in this way we can determine the molecular weight of unknown DNA molecule by utilizing the electrophoresis. So dear students, what are the application of agarose gel electrophoresis? Dear students, agarose gel electrophoresis routinely performed for the molecular diagnostic, for the identification of various genetic diseases. So due to the mutations in genetic or genes, the particular genetic disorders will be occur, and such type of genetic diseases we can diagnose, we can identify by using this gel electrophoresis. So mutated DNA and normal copy of DNA will separated within the gel. Okay, this agarose gel electrophoresis also utilized for the separation of nucleic acid. It may be RNA or it may be the DNA. So you know very well, in our laboratory we routinely isolate the genomic DNA, and after the isolation of genomic DNA we need to separate our DNA from the RNA. So for that purpose always we perform agarose gel electrophoresis, in which we load the sample. It may that sample containing RNA as well as the DNA, and after the completion of electrophoresis you can monitor where is the RNA and where is the DNA. This agarose gel electrophoresis also involve in the forensic science or forensic investigation, in which we want to develop the DNA fingerprint, right? So it may be the RFLP or it may be the PCR based DNA fingerprinting techniques, but in which we perform the electrophoresis, and with the electrophoresis we can separate the bands, or we can separate the DNA molecules, and we generate the DNA fingerprint of suspected one and victims. This gel electrophoresis also utilized in the DNA sequencing. Dear students, you know very well in the DNA sequencing, we run the DNA molecule which varying with the single nucleotide variations. Okay, so after the electrophoresis completed, we can monitor the bands, and on the basis of that bands, we can determine the sequence of our unknown DNA molecules. This agarose gel electrophoresis also utilized for the molecular mapping. So genetic mapping or it may be the physical mapping, we can construct by utilizing the gel electrophoresis. This agarose gel electrophoresis also utilized for the separation of PCR product. Dear students, you know very well the polymerase chain reaction we routinely perform in a laboratory for various purpose, and after the completion of PCR reaction, you should check your PCR product whether it is specific or not. So for that purpose, always we perform electrophoresis after the completion of your PCR to check your PCR product. So dear students, now we going to discuss about the second type of gel electrophoresis, and that is ESDS page electrophoresis. So this ESDS page nothing but the sodium dodecyl sulfate polyacrylamide gel electrophoresis. Dear student, this ESDS page routinely perform in a laboratory to separate the various types of protein molecules. Now this polyacrylamide gel electrophoresis we utilize for the separation of protein molecule. Why? Because whenever we prepare the polyacrylamide gel by addition of acrylamide and bisacrylamide in presence of the ammonium persulfate and thymate, there is a cross linking in between these two molecules, and there is a formation of solid polyacrylamide gel. Okay, so this, whatever the porosity of this polyacrylamide gel, that porosity is very suitable for the separation of protein molecules or variety of the protein molecules, and that's why we routinely perform SDS phase for the separation of protein molecules. Now dear students, question arises in our mind, polyacrylamide gel electrophoresis, why we call the SDS phase? The sodium dodecyl sulfate polyacrylamide gel electrophoresis means in this electrophoresis we prepared the gel, and during the preparation of gel we additionally add the molecule of SDS. So this sodium dodecyl sulfate we add during the preparation of polyacrylamide gel. So what are the functions of, what are the application of sodium dodecyl sulfate? So dear students, if you want to determine the molecular weight of your protein, or if you want to develop the protein profiling only, so we can perform the SDS phase, because this type of electrophoresis nothing but the analytical type of electrophoresis in which we are only interested in the determination of physical and chemical property of molecule, like molecular weight and how many subunits actually present in a particular protein molecule. So in SDS phase we use the polyacrylamide gel, and in that polyacrylamide gel we add SDS molecule. So basically, you know very well, whenever we prepare, whenever we isolate the protein from any cell, it may be plant or it may be microorganism or it may be the animal. So whenever we extract, whenever we isolate the total protein from the any cell, there may be some protein having a positive charge, some protein having a negative charge, and some protein having a neutral. So such type of sample, when we try to separate with the help of electrophoresis, and our ultimate aim is to determine the protein profiling, to determine the number of proteins. So we unable to separate the all proteins with the help of normal page. Why? Because when we load the sample toward the one end of electrode and your molecules travels toward the opposite electrode. If we load your sample toward the negative electrode, so only your negative charge bearing proteins able to travels toward the positive electrode through that gel. And we can visualize or we can separate only the positive negative charge bearing proteins, but we unable to separate the positively charged bearing proteins. And to minimize such type of problems, we use the SDS. Now in SDS space, SDS molecule can bind to the each and every protein. It may be positive or it may be negative charged protein. So SDS molecule can bind to every protein molecule and convert into the negative, because this SDS molecule already have a negative charge. So that's why, due to the binding of SDS molecule to the each and every proteins, now convert into the negatively charged protein. Okay, so initially some protein having positive charge, but due to the binding of SDS molecule to that proteins, now that proteins also convert into the negatively charged protein, and now all the proteins molecules bearing a same charge, that is negative charge. And when we load such type of sample toward the negative electrode, then there is, under the influence of electric current, all the different types of protein molecule start to migrate toward the opposite charge electrode. Why? Because now all the molecules having a same negative charge. Dear students, look at this slide. Before the SDS binding, your molecule looked like in such a way that means whatever the protein is there, so that protein may have a multiple subunits. Your protein may have a particular specific structure due to the binding of hydrogen bonding or disulfide bonding. Okay, so this protein molecule or this protein chain looked in a particular structure, but whenever the SDS molecule bind to this protein may denature, and after the binding of SDS molecule to the protein, your protein molecule looked in the linear form. So due to the binding of SDS molecule to the protein, your protein molecule get denatured and convert into the linear one. If your molecule contain the multiple subunits, means there is a 2-3 polypeptide chain bind to each other and form one single big molecules. But when we perform the SDS space, in which we can get the various types of bands. Why? Because there is a different subunits, and due to the denaturation of such type of complex protein and convert into the simpler subunits. Okay, so this is all about the SDS page principle. Now dear students, look at this slide. This molecule having a two subunits, and this molecule having a single unit. Okay, so single polypeptide chain. So these are the two samples. When we want to separate these two samples with the help of SDS page, then after the completion of your electrophoresis, we will get here the two bands. Okay, so in this well, you load this sample. So this sample is already having a two subunit, and due to the HGS phase, the HGS molecule bind to these molecules and denatured it, and the single molecules now convert into the two subunits. And these two polypeptide chain then run on the basis of its own molecular weight and form a two subunit or two bands. But in other hand, this one is the single polypeptide chain, and when your HGS molecule bind to this chain, denatured and comes into the linear, but total polypeptide chain act as a single molecule, and that's why this molecule appear is in the form of single bands, right? So in this way we can perform the HGS phase for the separation of molecule at a subunit level or at on the basis of molecular weight. Now dear student, I would like to explain the different components required for the HGS phase. This HGS phase routinely we perform in a vertical direction, and that's why this agar polyacrylamide gel electrophoresis also known as a vertical gel electrophoresis. So dear students, for the polyacrylamide gel electrophoresis we require the gel casting tray or gel cassette, then the electrode chamber in which we can pour the buffer or buffer, and we require the tank, buffer tank, and we require the comb as well as we require the cords for the for the electric supply, and we require the power supply also. So these are the various types of component required for the HGS page. Now apart from this, again we required the different types of chemicals. So we required the TMAID. This TMAID play an important role in the catalyzing the acrylamide polymerization. The reaction catalyzed by this TMAID or in presence of the TMAID, acrylamide molecule and bisacrylamide molecule cross link to each other and the polymerization occur. We required the ammonium persulfate. This ammonium persulfate also play an important role in the polymerization of acrylamide. And we required TRISSCL. It is a component of running buffer and gel casting buffer. We required the glycine. It is a component of running buffer. Then we required the bromophenol blue for the loading purpose and for the tracking of electrophoresis process. We required the Komasu Brilliant Blue. This dye we utilize for the visualization of protein band after completion of electrophoresis. So this Komasu Blue already replaced replaced to the ethidium bromide. Okay. And we require the sodium dodecyl sulfate because this one is the HGS phase, and we require acrylamide and bisacrylamide molecules for the preparation of polyacrylamide gel. So these are the various types of chemicals required for the polyacrylamide gel electrophoresis. Now dear students, I would like to explain the procedure of polyacrylamide gel electrophoresis, in which the first step is preparation of gel. Okay, so for the preparation, how will you prepare the gel in laboratory for performing the polyacrylamide gel? Okay, so dear students, we required the two glass plates, one glass plate with a notch and one glass plate without notch. So there is a two glass plates, rectangular two glass plates is required. So these two glass plates keep above to each other, and the in between these two glass plate there is a spacers. So with the help of spacer we can create the space in between two glass plates. Okay, so by keeping the spacer in three sides, okay, in a rectangular glass or square shaped glass plates, so there is a four directions or four sides, out of which only three directions or three sides we keep the spacers, and on the basis of thickness of that spacer, we can create the space in between these two plates. After placing that spacer, you need to seal proof this cassette or this glass plates assembly. So for that purpose, we can utilize the cello tapes or we can utilize the agarose gel. Okay, so we can use the grease also. So by utilizing the grease or cello tape, we can fix these two plates on each other with the space in between these two glass plates, okay, and assemble in such a way that the whatever the space or whatever the cavity created in between these two plates, it should be leak proof. So to check the leak, whether it is a leak proof or not, you can add some quantity of water within the two plates. Okay, if water start to comes out from the bottom side, it indicates that your assembly is not a leak proof. Then again you have to try to prepare the leak proof assembly. After again addition of your water and your water molecule unable to comes out from the bottom side or from the assembled glass plates, it indicates your assembly now a leak proof and suitable for the preparation of gel, suitable for the pouring of polyacrylamide gel. Dear students, in this polyacrylamide gel, we prepared the two different types of gel. One is a separating gel and another one is a stocking gel. So separating gels should be at bottom side, and on the separating gel there is a stocking gel. Okay, so first of all we prepared the separating gel and then pour into the assembly, allow it to solidify. After the solidification, then you can prepare the stocking gel and then that stocking gel pour into the assembly, okay, and again allow it to solidify. So in this way we can prepare the gel in which there is a two types of gels within the same unit, separating gel and stocking gel. Stocking gel always present above on the separating gel. Now after the preparation of gel in such a way that, then you can keep this gel cassette into the electrode chamber and then that electrode chamber keep into the buffer tank, okay, and then that buffer tank filled with the two different types of buffer, cathode buffer and anode buffer, and then you can load the sample in the vein. Okay, so basically I would like to explain what is the separating gel and what is stocking gel, or why we prepared the two different types of gel in a polyacrylamide gel electrophoresis. So dear students, first of all we prepared the separating gel which having a high concentration as compared to the stocking gel. So routinely we prepared the separating gel with the concentration of 7.5 to 10 or 12, 15 and 20. Depending upon our need, we can prepare the 7.5 to 20% acrylamide gel as a separating gel. These separating gels able to resolve, able to separate the bands, and that's why separate the protein molecule. That's why this gel known as a separating gel or resolving gels. Dear students, for the preparation of separating gel, we should add The distilled water, 30% acrylamide solution, 1.5 molar trichloride, 10% SDS, T-made, and 10% ammonium persulfate in an appropriate quantity. If you want to prepare the 7.5, then you can add the appropriate volume of this all component. So by mixing all the component in a beaker, we prepared separating gel. Okay, but keep in your mind, separating gel is a high concentrated gel with a low porosity and as compared to the stocking gel. Okay, so first of all, we prepared the separating gel and then pour into the assembly. After that, after the solidification of separating gel, then you can prepare the stocking gel which having a low concentration as compared to the separating gel. I will explain the applications or purpose of these two gels separately. So normally, dear students, we perform, we prepared 4% acrylamide stocking gel for the SDS page. Okay. So these are the different components. Again, we add or mix together at different volumes of, as per our need, and we can prepare the 4%. It is also ranging from 4% to 6%. So normally we prepare stocking gel which is ranging from 4% to the 6%, and separating gel is ranging from 7.5 to 20%. It is depends upon what type of protein molecule or protein sample you want to separate it. Now, dear students, after the preparation of separating, after the preparation of gel or after the casting of gel, then your gel should keep into the electrode cavity or electrode chamber. Okay. So before going to discuss about the loading, first of all, I would like to explain the application or purpose of the separating gel and stocking gel. Okay. So dear students, look at this light. You can observe here, this one is, means initially we pour the separating gel. So it is 2/3 part of the gel. So this one is the separating gel, and this above the separating gel, this one is the stocking gel. After the pouring of stocking gel, you have to keep the comb inside the stocking gel, okay, and allow it to solidify. After 1 to 2 hours, it is completely solidified, then you can remove these combs, and in this way there will be create the veins which are utilized for the sample application or for the loading of protein samples. Okay. Now dear students, when we second step is application of your sample. Okay. So now we consider our gel vertically keep inside the electrode chamber. Okay. In connection with the upper tank and lower tank. Now, in this way, in this diagram, you can observe this one is the upper tank and this one is the lower tank and this one is the vertical gel. Okay. Now, your gel present in between the two glass plates. Okay. Whenever you keep this cassette or gel cassette in an assembly, you should remove the spacer which is present at the bottom side. Okay. So, after removal of the spacer, then you can keep the gel in this direction. Now, dear students, you can now ready for the loading of sample. In the same way, here also we should prepare your sample, okay, because your protein sample also having a low density, and that's why you should prepare your sample by mixing with that of the loading buffer. So here also we can use the same loading buffer which already we use in a agarose gel electroporosis. So in agarogel electrophoresis already I explained the property of loading buffer, why we use that loading buffer and what are the applications of that loading buffer. So that same loading buffer we use to prepare the protein samples also, and by mixing the protein sample with that of the loading 6x loading buffer, we prepared the samples and load into the wells. Okay, so inside the wells you can load your sample. It may be the 10 to 15 or 20 microliter with the help of micropipettes. So you should carefully load this sample into the well. So before the loading, you should immerse your pipette tips inside the wells, and after the confirmation your tip successfully now present in a well, then you can dispense your sample slowly in the well. Okay, so you can here observe here the loading of sample. Okay, so dear student, this one is tank, already tank filled with the buffer, and this one is the lower tank, it is also filled with the buffer. Okay, now after the in such a way that we load all the different types of samples in a different wells. Okay, after sample application, after sample loading, then you have to connect this electrode with a power pack. Okay, after connection, switch on the electric current and your process now start. Okay, now whenever apply the electric current, under the influence of electric current, your molecules start to migrate. Okay, now what happen, why we prepare the stocking gel at above, because you already know, I already explained, the stocking gel having a low concentrations. Okay, the porosity will be higher than separating gel. So the cavity present in a stocking gel. So in the well, when we load the sample, so initial concentration of that sample is very high. Okay, and that's why when we apply the electric current, at a time all the samples may start to migrate toward the forward direction, and it will block the wells. Okay, the pore adjacent to the wells may block due to the high concentration of your molecule. So if for to minimize the such type of problem, we should prepare the stocking gel in which the pore size already bigger, and that's why when we under the influence of electric current, at a time when all the particles start to migrate, so as compared to the size or as compared to the shape of your molecule, the pore size are very large, and that's why there is no any possibility of blockage. So this one is the first purpose to prepare the stocking gel. Okay, to minimize the blockage of wells. Okay, then second type of gel, that is a separating gel. Okay, so when your molecule migrated toward the forward direction within the stocking gel, at that time your stocking gel do not apply any sieving force or friction force on the molecules, because there is a big difference in between the size of pore and your protein molecules. But whenever your protein molecule reach to the separating gel, so here the sieving force acted by your medium start on each molecule. So now each molecule facing sieving force of medium, and that sieving force is directly proportional to the molecular weight. Higher the molecular weight, higher the sieving force acted by your medium on the molecule. Lower the molecular weight, lower sieving force acted by your medium. Okay, so on the basis of different molecular weight, your molecules start to migrate in a forward direction with a different speed. Okay, so low molecular weight fastly migrate and cover the larger distance, and high molecular weight molecule slowly migrate and cover the less distance. Okay, so in this way our molecule gets separated within the gel. Now dear students, after the completion of polyacrylamide gel electrophoresis, then there is a steps protein visualization. So you can observe here, this one is the picture of gel. Okay, so this picture containing the various types of protein bands, and it looked like in a blue color or purple color. So for the visualization of your band patterns or protein samples within the gel, you should use the specific dye, that is Komasu blue dye. So routinely in our laboratory we utilize Komasu blue as a dye for the visualization of protein band after completion of polyacrylamide gel electrophoresis. We can use the silver staining also for the protein visualization. Okay, but commonly we use Komasu blue. So your gel should be keep inside the Komasu blue dye or Komasu blue solution, keep for long, 1 to 2 hours, and within that incubation period your protein molecules already stained with the Komasu blue. And after that you should again remove your gel and destain the gel. Why? Because to removal of excess stain molecule from the gel. When we complete the destaining procedure, then we start to appear the various types of bands. Okay, so in this way we can visualize the proteins bands in a SDS space by utilizing the Komasu blue. This one is the picture of silver staining. You can use the silver staining also. Silver staining is usually 10 to 100 times more sensitive than Komasu blue staining, but it is more complicated, and that's why in the laboratory we routinely use Komasu blue. So this one is the silver staining picture. Dear students, now we are going to discuss about the application of SDS page. Now this SDS page mostly we perform in a laboratory to separate the various types of protein samples. Sometime in a diagnostic laboratory we perform SDS page to identify the particular marker protein, which are disease specific marker protein. So we can say this electrophoresis, SDS page electrophoresis, we can utilize for the molecular diagnostic, in which we can identify, we can diagnose the various types of diseases. This SDS page also utilized for the development of protein profiling in forensic investigation. For example, the isoenzymes is there, so we can develop the protein profile of isoenzymes, and on the basis of that isoenzyme pattern we can identify the suspected one or crime attempt in a forensic investigation. This SDS page also utilized in research, in which we work on protein specifically. Then we can utilize this SDS page to determine the protein molecular weight, or to determine the molecular weight of unknown protein sample. So dear students, this one is all about the SDS page. Now I am going to discuss about the one more type of polyacrylamide gel electrophoresis, that is native gel electrophoresis. So dear students, what is difference between the SDS page and native page. I already explained in SGS page there is additionally we add the sodium dodecyl sulfate. That sodium dodecyl sulfate is a detergent molecule, and this detergent molecule convert all protein into the negative charge protein. But in the SDS page molecule, that SDS molecule able to denature the protein, and that's why that sometime if you want to isolate the functional protein, we need to isolate the protein in its original state, in its native state, native conformational state. So we cannot use the SDS page, because SDS page disrupt the native form of protein, disrupt the native structure of that protein, and that's why that protein are non-functional. But in some situation we need a functional protein. We are interested to separate the functional protein. It may be hormone, it may be enzymes, or it may be the therapeutically important proteins. So that functional protein should perform its own function after the isolation of that protein. So this type of protein separation by utilizing the native page. And this native page also known as the preparative page. So we can prepare, we can isolate the functional protein. For that purpose, we need to perform the native page. So native means what? The polyacrylamide gel electrophoresis able to separate such type of molecules which are native in structure and functional in structure, are functionally active. So this is actual difference in between the SDS page and native page. So dear students, in the native page we do not add SDS molecule during the preparation of polyacrylamide gel, and without the SDS we prepared polyacrylamide gel, and remaining procedure of native page is exactly similar with that of the SDS page. Just here we utilize the gel without SDS, and that's why we able to isolate, that's why we able to extract or separate the functional protein from the sample. So this native page routinely we perform for the examination of protein-protein interaction or protein ligand interaction, or this native page also utilized for the detection of protein isoforms or conforms. So here I would like to conclude my today's lecture. If you have any questions regarding this lecture, you can ask on this number. My mobile number is 9096578077. Thank you.